And that bare minimum allows them to get a few more bottles out of that single cask, but going from 46 down to 40, you can stretch it just a little farther if you have to.
You're talking about stretching it a little bit, getting a few more bottles. You're talking, considering the profit margins involved in alcohol, you're talking a rather small percentage margin between a branded presentation of single malt whiskey and a decent craft presentation of single malt whiskey. And you can ask anyone, anywhere, anytime, what do they prefer? They prefer the quality presentation over the brand presentation with single malts. And you'll find this is a benefit to the independent bottlers. That's still where they have the strength and their strong hand in the whiskey market.
Who's doing it right?
The small craft distillers, for me, are doing it right. Spring Mank has always been doing it right, and they do everything on site. Still the only distillery that does so, although others have plans to change that. Ben Romach does it right. Ben Riach, Blatnick. Am I talking about all independent distillers here? I think I probably am. All good strength to the elbow of the big brand people. They're the ones that spend the big massive marketing budgets going out there and opening up the markets, developing the markets, and supplying the lion's share of the cash to actually protect the reputation and the interests of the Scotch whisky industry. Although at times I think the decisions can be a little bit clumsy. But you know, you can't blame the tiger for having claws. So the Scotch Whisky Association and the big companies, they do a good job of putting whisky out there. But I think so long as there's the opportunity for the small craft distillers to follow them out and then pick up on people's rising expectations in what they get in the glass, because it's amazed me considerably at the quality of the correspondence and emails that I've been getting in my site from young people all around the world who are really latching on so fast as to what whisky is all about.
And part of that is because of the medium you're using on the internet, as we do here at WhiskeyCast, in that young people are more comfortable watching a YouTube video or watching a video on your site, or listening to a podcast on WhiskeyCast, than they are going out and trying to buy a book about whiskey or reading about it. Is this the way we're going to bring younger consumers to whiskey?
Without a doubt, yes. It's not that long ago that people would buy single malt whiskies, brand loyal, and if they wanted to know any more, they'd march into the bookshop, they'd go up to the wine section and see if they were lucky enough to get a book of single malt whisky. Things have changed, and I think what impresses you and I is that we're witnessing the speed of change, which is quite phenomenal, and we're right there to supply a need for a young generation who have gone out, they've bought a bottle of whisky, they're sitting at home, they're sitting with pals, and they say, hang about, I'd like to know more. They just go and they do a Google search, a Yahoo search, any search at all, and we're there. And we can respond, whether it be the malt maniacs, one of the world's best sites, whether it be Serge Valentin with his excellent whisky fun, your own podcasts, Mark, all due respect, fantastic, consistent, and excellent. And you're welcome. And a number of other commentators. It's not like buying a book where you get one opinion. You go online, in your first page of your search, you're going to get a number of opinions which are articulate. And kids with their experience, searching every day of the week, they're used to it. They know how to sift the average or what they're not looking for and quickly home in on what they are looking for. And they're learning because they can go from link to link, they can cross-reference, they can say, for example, right, I've got a bottle of Glenfiddich. I'm not quite getting all these flavour notes, I'm not sure about it, so let's go to Whiskey Fun, let's go to Maniacs, let's go to caskstrength.net, let's go to all these bloggers who can go into their blog site, just for researching. Within 5 minutes, I can get five different opinions of Glenfiddich. I can put them together, and I can get an accurate picture like never before.
Since we've already expressed that you are learned that you don't like chill filtering, you don't like caramel coloring, What's your take on finishes?
finishes, depends on the quality of the finish. We'll start with wine finishes, will we? I can quite understand that if a distillery is going to buy in a wine cask, they're probably buying some pretty good wood, particularly French, Italian, Spanish, and it's really the wood they should be after. If the spirit is going into the cask and remaining there for sufficient length of time for the interaction to be significant and substantial, fine. If it is a superficial coating to beef up a tired, flat old cask which is giving nothing to the whiskey and the whiskey is simply not responding as a result, then to sugar coat it for 2 months, 3 months with a unrinsed wine cask to get a few cranberry and raspberry notes in amongst the grain, well, forget it. Of course, Glenmorangie pioneered the wood finishes, and if you were to try some of the early bottlings of the port mature Glenmorangie, excellent whiskey. And recently, another example of a good wine finished, a good finished whiskey, with Springbank's mature whiskey, Springbank's Madeira, 11-year-old, absolutely superb stuff. And they also did Tokaj. Now, I'm not a fan of Tokaj, but these sweet wines, when they're used for finishing whiskey, we know that because other spirit producers do it, sugar and sweetness will always cover rough alcohol, blemishes, sulfuriness, and we're aware of that. So to kind of come across a Tokaj mature Springbank Longrow, I'm thinking, I'm not quite sure about this, you know. It was excellent, it was superb. Of course, I've tasted some others of the little mints. I wouldn't name the distillery, there was one that just tasted exactly like the smell of the petrol.
And as an undertaker,
yes,
what have you found that smells remarkably similar to embalming fluid?
Let me see. Now, without firing off a few pelters, I have come across some Italian grappa. Now, don't get me wrong, grappa varies considerably, but oh boy, when it's bad, it's bad. When it's good, it really can be exceptional. And I've come across some superbly fantastic grappa recently from Rayburn's in Edinburgh. Zubair, who in fact is the micro-independent bottler of the bottler's range. And he's basically, I think, trying to bring back a few casks of that. A very discerning gentleman when it comes to his whiskey, and he recommended I try some grappa, and it was totally fabulous. What was it, Carlo Govetti? I hope I'm not kind of going to make this guy off a busy now. It's just a little Italian grappa producer. He's successive family generations, he's just working away in the little family still, and he's producing something fantastic. And here's a clear signal there's a shakedown going on between the big brand producers who are going one direction and the small artisan producers all around the world, whatever they're doing, whether it be mezcal, whether it be port, whether it be palinka from Hungary. I think we've got a lot to see from Hungary with their plum palinka, apricot, and even tomato spirit. I've not come across that. I've heard some very interesting and positive things about that. So I'm going to be looking out for it. But that's the thing about the internet. News travels fast.
And we're starting to see a lot of these countries develop their own whiskey industries too. What countries are interesting you in terms of whiskey other than Scotland and the major whiskey producing nations? What countries are you most interested in seeing whiskeys from?